Hi, my name's Josh Waihi. I work at Acquia and have been there now for about coming up 10 months. I've been in the Drupal community now for coming up 8 years. In my career, I've been predominantly a developer, and I moved into architecture from Drupal architecture and then out into more infrastructure stuff. Nowadays, I work with some of Acquia's elite accounts, and there I deal with enterprise stuff, right? That could be lots of users, it could be lots of traffic, it could be lots of data. It's always lots of money, right? So today I wanted to, I deal a lot with performance issues, it's a pretty common thing, and I wanted to just talk about some of the building blocks, what I think are the building blocks of performance and how to understand those and be able to prevent making bad choices as soon as you can so that you can save yourself money, whether that's hosting costs or development costs or support costs. And also ensure that you keep your customers happy at the end of the day. And I think that's as much as this is a DevOps track and we're talking about technical things, we do all of this to keep our customers happy. And I think sometimes we lose sight of that a little bit. So I'll be sort of talking a little bit about that as well. Before we do get going, though, I do have one disclaimer about my talk, and that's that it is about performance, and that's not the same thing as availability. Availability is, what can I do to ensure that my site never goes down? And performance is certainly a factor of that, right? Like, if it's a slow site, then you've got a higher chance of it going down. That sort of factors into availability, but it's not necessarily availability. And in fact, the infrastructural choices that we make are often at a performance defect, but we do that so that we have high availability. So I'll mention that because I don't want to be talking about architectures that are unrealistic, that are not a part of the industry standard, but I'll be focusing predominantly on performance rather than availability. So this talk focuses on three areas, or I've broken the building blocks down into three main areas. The first one is understand, so it's going to be very sort of generic because there's a lot of technologies around, there's a lot of ways of doing things, so we kind of need to look at this at a very broad approach. So the first one is understand. It's really about learning up front what the requirements are of the site. Too regularly, I've seen there's sort of a one-size-fits-all approach in Drupal, and it's very true for Drupal because it's so flexible, dynamic, and do a lot of things, and we have a great community that provides very stable ways of doing things, and so we're very quick to jump into those and just move forward. The second one is actually just building the thing. Once we understand first, then we can go and build against what we understand and not sort of just jumping in before that part. And then the third part is to optimize. So a sort of iterative process, load testing, being able to ensure that the application can do what we intended for it to do. So let's jump into it. The first part is understand. To me, performance means purpose-built. And that's a really hard concept to grasp, I think, in the Drupal community because Drupal's so flexible. Drupal's often chosen because it can be applied to so many different use cases. It can be a social media site, a commerce site, it can be a campaign site, it can be all of those things in one. And so we kind of go, yeah, Drupal can do the job, and we just throw it up there. But if you think of Drupal like a person, every person's different, and athletes in particular, they focus their lifestyle and condition their body to perform the task that they want to do. So, you're not going to see a weightlifter run a 100-meter sprint, or if you do, you'd be a very lucky person, that would be a special moment. It's more to the fact that, if you want something that's going to do heavy lifting, you want a lot of muscle. If you want something that's going to be quick and nimble, then that kind of thing can be more better suited for sprinting. So, I always try and first start off with an understanding to understand what it is that you want to do. What are the characteristics of the Drupal site, of the users, the data that you have, that will reflect on the kind of infrastructure you might need. And I break that down into let's think about what are the areas that we need to cover off when we're talking about understanding things. And again, I break those down to three areas. The first of which is data. So data is, you know, what are you storing inside of Drupal? So the users, the content, the categorization. Sometimes, you know, you might have 100,000 users, and sorry, you might have 100,000 pieces of content and maybe 40,000 taxonomy terms. But when you're crossing, cross-categorizing content with terms, you end up with millions of rows in the database because of how heavy you're doing your utilization. At that point, do not use the taxonomy index table. Okay. So you need to understand the kind of data that you're storing and how much of it is and how complex the using of that data becomes. The second one is understanding your traffic. Just because you have 100,000 nodes doesn't mean that you're going to have a million hits per day, right? So you might have a lot of storage requirements, but you won't have necessarily a lot of traffic requirements. So validate that if you have a pre-existing site, look at the old old analytics and see what the traffic might be, because obviously what you use at the front end is going to be different to what you use at the back end. The third one is automation. So what kind of heavy lifting tasks might happen that aren't traffic bound? So if you're doing content ingestion, things that enterprise systems might do that a normal Drupal site might not do. So not just cron running, but maybe things like bulk reporting or reconciliation with commerce payment gateways and things. So here's a couple of examples of what that might look like when you do evaluations. So a campaign site, it could be high in traffic and sort of medium range in data. And not really much any automation. So you think like an election campaign site thing or something for social media likes or something like that. You'll get a lot of traffic through, but there's not a lot of groundwork, right? But because it's predominantly anonymous, in most cases you can get away with a very small build because you can sort of leverage a whole bunch of page caching. In contrast, a community site, you have a lot of authenticated users. Now, the user rate might be lower, but you're going to need bigger servers. So, in contrast to the campaign site where you might have had a million hits in a day, you might only get, say, 100 users visit your site per day in this instance, or 1,000 as I've put up here. But that because you're logged in and you're engaging, there's more engagement between the server and the user, you have to have bigger resources to deal with the additional load. Finally, with the commerce side, if you have a lot of automation, you're making a lot of transactions, you've got to talk to the payment gateway, do reconciliations, build reports for the business guys so they can see how well the site's proven out. You may want to consider taking your automation, things like cron tasks and stuff, and running that on an independent server so that it's not impacting the load when you have traffic-bound content, traffic-bound load coming onto your sites. Summarizing, understand your resource requirements before we go into the build part. Understand your applications, resources, so that it can enable you to build the infrastructure that meets the needs of the project and not just a sort of stock standard out-of-the-box idea. So let's talk a bit about build. And I have a catchphrase here, which is like scale vertically, then scale horizontally. Have you guys heard those terms before in architecture? Yeah. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what those two terms mean. The key thing here is that you use the first before you use the second. So you always scale vertically before you scale horizontally. So again, like understand, build is broken down to three areas. First, the architecture. So I'm just going to cover off the different kinds of architecture that we have in the industry and why they're used in particular ways. The second one is the software, so we're just going to go over a few options that there are available in that are sort of common in the Drupal industry. And the third one is application, so looking at things from actually inside Drupal itself. This talk doesn't talk too much about the application component at all, but rather these are the things for your developers to look at and consider as well. So let's start off with architecture and how it works in the industry. So the first very smallest thing that we have for a Drupal build is the single tier, or more commonly called the LAMP stack. And whenever we get into Drupal development, this is the sort of thing that we've become most comfortable with, which is hosting everything inside of a single server. So everything is made up of the web server, so that might be something like Apache or Nginx, and that then offloads requests to Drupal, which is being run by PHP, and there's a number of different PHP runtime environments that you can run these days. You also have to have your files partition, where Drupal saves its file data, and then you also have the database, and the database will be something like, in most cases, it's MySQL, MariaDB, Kona. And that's your single-tier architecture in a box. And it's pretty cheap, right? It's just one box. It's, you can buy a VM dedicated server now for $5 a month or cheaper perhaps, and you can run Drupal on that. It's not going to, it's not going to do your campaign site, right? You're not going to be able to serve more than one user, but it'll do the trick, and it works really well for developers. Works really well in sort of development staging environments, and you can sort of upsize the hardware a bit larger if you like, and get perhaps a few more users through to it. But the key problem with this architecture is that all of those all of that software inside of the operating system is fighting for resources inside of the operating system. So if you imagine a typical server might have, say, two CPUs, and let's say this is Linux just to make things easier, the CPUs will where the resources for those CPUs is managed by the kernel, and the kernel will just handle things and increase load as it needs to be able to manage everything. But there's only two CPUs, right? There's four pieces of software and running here, and only two CPUs. So you can only do two concurrent things, so everything else will be waiting until the other piece is finished. So as soon as you get up to, say, three requests per second, the thing starts to collapse and the load will start ramping up, and you can't really go beyond that because of the limitations. So we start scaling vertically. And to go vertically, it means that we sort of bring the architecture outward. So the first step we would do for that is to separate the database from the web server. So that means that when PHP gets CPU bound, and it does because it's running Drupal, and that's just a part of what it is, then you don't want that CPU load to affect the database. So that means that database continues to be performant, and later as we scale out horizontally, that it allows us to operate in a more effective manner. So now it also starts to introduce the idea of turning our resources into components and being able to diagnose and understand them from performance level. So, what happens when you start getting a million hits per second? Well, that doesn't happen, but, like a thousand hits per second. Well, when that happens, it's really hard for you to understand what's going on inside of the server. Which request made this load go that high, and why is everything sort of collapsing? So as soon as you start to put things into different servers, it becomes a lot easier because the operating system is really good at measuring itself and not the software. So you can just look at it and say, okay, the CPU load is high on the Drupal server and not on the database server. Therefore, the problem's not in the database, and you can start continuing to look at deeper into the application. From there, we go into what I would call HA, or multi-tier, so high availability. So this is where we start to scale out the architecture a little bit further. And because we have two web servers now in play instead of just the one, we also have to put a balancer in front that can offload the requests to the two different web servers. So we've done two things here. We've done another vertical step where we've added a load balancer in front, but we've also scaled out horizontally as well now. So the balancer is sort of necessary to be able to do that horizontal scaling. But it also means that now we can start to expand our load across multiple web servers. And in a Drupal architecture, the Drupal component is the part that's scalable horizontally. The database is not really that scalable horizontally unless you really want to get pull your sleeves up and get into it quite deeply. So ideally, you want to be in a place where if you are having a bottleneck in your application anywhere in the infrastructure, you want it to be CPU bound in the web server layer, because that way you can scale it out. If it's somewhere else, you have to do application optimization to be able to get rid of it. And so for the availability component of that, we'd also be adding in double everything. So for example, in a Amazon architecture, you'd see a line down the middle, and you'd have two availability zones inside of a single site. And you would have them, each component in one side, so that if the the region was to be, well, half that availability zone was to be collapsed, you'd still have half the architecture left over. And so you do things like database and file replication so that you can switch over without compromising. Yeah, it's all availability stuff, which we won't go into too deeply, but in an industry standard architecture, you'll have those additional two components that I just popped up there so that you can roll over to them if you need to. And so once you have that in place, it becomes easier and easier to scale things out, and so you continue to scale out your web service as you need to, as the concept, and you don't have to scale out your database server. So if we think about the very first slide, this one, if we had tried to scale that horizontally without doing the vertical scaling first, then the database would have been in every single web server, and that's just pointless because Drupal can't write to several different web servers. So it's very important that you go through these steps, and for your project and for your application, you need to figure out what the best one is. I mean, this by all means would be the ideal situation for everybody, but it also happens to cost the most. So you kind of need to find the balance of what you can afford versus how much gain you can get out of it. But from an infrastructure perspective, doing that kind of vertical scaling is really advantageous. Oh, so the question was, are both balances in load, or is one just a spare? The answer is it's a spare, because in most cases that's a Varnish server, and if you're load balancing two balances, then you're also splitting your cache in half, your hit rate in half. So you want to send all your requests through single one, and then if it fails over, you roll over to the other one. Yeah. And there's other tricks you can do in Varnish to loop the two together if you wanted to, but yeah, extras for experts. There's also other components inside of Drupal that you can scale vertically as well. A lot of people kind of forget about this part, actually. So Drupal, by default, is sort of constrained by the LAMP stack. As a community project, you want it to work on as least amount of technology as necessary. But for really building a proper application, there's actually components inside of Drupal that you want to fork off into its own dedicated server or component or software that's better at doing the task than what Drupal is doing the task for. So some examples of that is the caching layer is a big one. That's normally written to the database. If you think about what a SQL transactional database is designed to do, it's not designed to store cache. It's just the only thing that Drupal has is a persistent storage, so it uses it. Other one is the locking mechanism. So Drupal has a locking API, it lets you do atomic locking, so you can do atomic operations. But again, the database kit is where it's stored, and if you try and write and too frequently to the rows in that table, when you get some concurrency going, that system starts to fail as well. The queuing system is another one. Drupal has actually got a pretty good queuing system, and it's reliable to some point, but when you start sending messages to the queue that at such a high velocity, again, you start to tax the database. Remember, the database is used to pull out content and render it, and the views module, right, is sending bad queries to your database server, so you need to save your resources for those bad queries. You don't want to have to use the queuing system. And again, like, because these are separate components, you don't want to have them fail when database becomes slower, or you don't want database to become slower because they're failing. So that's a reason why you want to abstract these components out. And the final one is search. Everyone knows that core search is really bad. There's plenty of options these days, like Solr Search or Elasticsearch, that take care of that for you. So there are, like I mentioned, there's a number of different alternatives for here. So for cache, there's Memcache, Redis, APC. APC, though, works on a per-server basis, depending on your implementation of PHP. Locking, you can use either Memcache or Redis. The queuing system, there's Amazon SQS if you're on AWS. There's RabbitMQ or ActiveMQ. Or Redis again. And then there's also Apache Solr and Elasticsearch, as I mentioned, for searching. So when you plug these components into your architecture, you start to get a bigger picture. And this next slide, I really didn't have enough space to put everything in. But essentially, you can start really expanding your architecture out a lot further and putting these additional components in. Now, you obviously take on the latency and network connectivity, but you gain a freer application. So if you If you're running at the moment, like in this diagram, I put cache and search in the same box. That's a really bad idea, actually, because they're both really RAM intensive, so that wouldn't work very well at all. But you know, like the idea is you don't want the one component of your architecture to pull the rest of your application down. So if you separate them out, it stops them from doing that, and they fail alone rather than together. And you know, not having search available on your site is certainly better than not having a site available. So this part is just, I'm going to go over a couple of graphs like this. This talks about some of the technologies or methods, architectures that we can use, and it's all, this is not statistically sound, like this is just how I score things out of five, right, rather than, I don't have any data to back this up. It's completely my opinion. So in terms of hosting, when you're buying servers, there's three ways you can do that: raw metal, virtualization, and cloud. Raw metal being you actually buy a proper server. You've got to pay for that server. You've got to pay for hosting that server, and you don't have a lot of flexibility out of it, right? If you need another server, you've got to go buy a whole new one. But you get a lot of performance out of that, and I think some experts in this area might tell you that the gains in performance in raw metal are not all that much more than what you might get in the cloud. But usually the reason that someone would buy something in raw metal these days is either A, the security component if they're hosting it in their own data center, or B, because they think that it's more performant. But what you usually find is because we have architecture that is designed to do horizontal scaling is that the problem with this is if you don't know how performant, how much load's going to be on your servers, you don't know how many you're going to need to buy, it becomes a problem because you could either spend too much money and have all the servers be underutilized, or you can spend not enough money and then you go over and then you have to go order a new server and it's a couple of weeks before it comes and it's all a whole bunch of overhead. So alternatively, cloud and virtualization offer a lot more flexibility. So virtualization, for those who are wondering how that differs from cloud, virtualization is where you might take a raw metal server and put a virtualization layer on top of it. So unlike cloud, a single instance can move across multiple machines. Virtualization would continue to exist on that one machine and tax it and tax all the resources underneath it. But you can say at the host machine that that virtualized machine is only allowed X amount of resources. So it gives you that compartmentalization between each component. So I think you probably, most people, out of curiosity, who's hosting the cloud these days? It's a good chunk. People who are doing virtualization, still a fair chunk, and people on raw metal. Wow, it's a few of you guys. Cool. So yeah, I think this is kind of a fair idea of what that is, and so it's probably more than these things are the reasons why you go to those areas. A lot of people go to cloud because it's cost effective and it's flexible. Some people want to do virtualization because they want to do it themselves, and then others do raw metal because they just, for whatever reason, either security or the performance. Web server technology, in most cases, and I think what I try to swing towards more in this talk is, if you're here and you're thinking about what sort of web server should I use? I just went to Speedy and apparently Nginx is the way to go, or you're unsure about the web server to use. I would say go with Apache, even though it's really poor performer, just because it does Drupal better. And you can do other things like putting Nginx and Varnish in front of it, which will help speed up the connection component. So if you're, that's the web server part is purely about running Drupal. It's little to do with the performance component. And when you're thinking about how many processes you can run of PHP on a server, it's not massive, right? It doesn't go to 128 or 64 concurrent PHP processes. It goes more to if you're in 20, you're kind of in your limit. So why do you need to do more than 20 concurrent connections, right, unless you're serving static files? So the performance requirement isn't necessarily there. Therefore, I weigh in and think that the community support is more vital because it does more of the work for you. But certainly Nginx is pretty fast and it's got a lot of community support in Drupal as well. And there's definitely a lot of ways that you can do that stuff if you want to. So by all means, jump in there and do it. I was going to talk about PHP runtime, and then I realized that there's not really worth doing it because there's only one real option at the moment, with the exception of the sort of future state of things like hip-hop and in the later versions of PHP, at the moment we have three things. We've got FPM, Fast CGI, and Mod PHP. And the other two other than FPM are actually so flawed that they're not worth using. So if you're using them at the moment, consider changing. I'll explain why. The PHP CGI is essentially, FPM came about because CGI wasn't doing a good enough job. It's terrible at keeping itself active. You have to constantly have something monitoring it to keep it alive. Mod PHP is not rated, is not limited by, it doesn't have a limitation of how many PHP processes it can open up other than your max client set in Apache. Therefore, it's quite possible that if you haven't configured Apache, your server will expand out to 256 PHP processes, which at 128 megabytes of memory limit means about 30 gig of RAM that it will need just to operate. And of course, you don't have that, you're going to go to swap, you don't have the CPU to deal with that, and so you'll get overloaded and you'll have to restart the machine, which is means you have to have human resources to keep your site operational. So you need to get rid of Mod PHP, migrate away from PHP CGI, and start using FPM because it has so much more value to it. You can even have multiple PHP applications running and separate them out in different pools, or even have different pools for different purposes. It's just fantastic. Also, pro tip about APC cache. So if you're using FPM, the APC cache is stored at the parent process so that every child uses the same cache, which is not the case if you're using CGI, which means you can use less amount of memory. Database software, I think probably most people here be using a MySQL or a variant of it, but just for giggles, there's other ones out there. There's certainly people here who will suggest you use others, but for the most part, MySQL would probably be the general choice just because it has the most compatibility with Drupal. I know some organizations will say, well, no, we standardize on Oracle or MySQL Server and, sorry, MS SQL. And if they force you into it, it just makes it more complex. And the reality is Drupal doesn't use those features, those advanced features of those servers that make it performant. So you don't get any advantage of using those kinds of servers. So really, the only choice in this case, in most cases, is MySQL or Postgres. SQLite is single, you can't actually do concurrent connections with it, so don't even think about that. So we'll quickly move through the other sort of other abstraction layers. So Solr, Elastic, and Google are some other options opposed to Core for search. For HTTP caching, there's certainly Nginx, Vanish, and Squid. You can do caching in Nginx if you like, and a lot of people rate it over Vanish. I think the configuration's a bit more trickier than writing VCL personally. Vanish has really great support, and it's almost like a standard now in our industry. So that would be my recommendation. Drupal Core does it out of the box if you don't really have the resources to do caching. There are several reasons why that's a really bad idea, but if you've got nothing else, then at least have that. Caching software opposed to the front-end stuff. So Memcache, Redis, and APC are probably those options. These aren't necessarily mutually exclusive in this instance, so you could, say, use Memcache for a whole bunch of caching, and then you could use Redis where you need to do wildcard purging, and then you might do APC for your cache, your bootstrap cache, where the localized lookup registry is really important, for example. Queuing software, I just put AMPQ, that's the standard for messaging. So things like SQS, RabbitMQ, and ActiveMQ all support that. And then Redis is an alternative, which just does queuing as well. And locking software, Memcache and Redis, again, they're all high, got a lot of support in the community, Drupal community, and are pretty quick as well. Sorry, I read that a bit quick if you wanted to take a snap. Yeah, sorry, Memcache is under Redis there. It's really bad graphing, but the two are pretty much equal on par in that aspect. So summary, scale vertically first, then scale out horizontally, and use the software that best fits your abilities. So if you think you're ready for the challenge of taking on a new piece of software, then, you know, by all means, jump into it. But if you're thinking of using it purely because you've been told it was a good idea, perhaps rethink that again and use something that you're more comfortable with using, because ultimately, when performance problem hits, you need to know how to fix that. And if it's a brand new technology and you're a bit out of your depth, then you're just left with an application that doesn't do what it's supposed to. So the third part we're going to talk about is optimize. Again, that's made up of out of three areas. The first one is testing. I think this is a really important one, and one that people get wrong a lot. So, you know, that's building accurate test plans and accurately mimicking a production environment. Then there's measuring. So, you know, putting things into your architecture that allows you to measure what's going on in your system. So that's things like the monitoring that you have, whether that's like Nagios, Cacti, New Relic, or, you know, there's lots of options out there, and logging as well, so that you can look back through your logs and sort of replay what happened and figure out what went wrong. And then analyze. So figuring out, looking through all of that data, figuring out what the problem is, identifying it, fixing it, and then reiterating, right? So going back to the load testing plan and trying to fix it and sort it out. So I can't stress this part enough, and this is really a most important part for the business, I think, is that if you can't simulate your production load, then there's no point in doing your load testing. So, and the reason for that is a lot of this comes around back to the confidence of your customer. The customer wants to know, is it safe to launch? Is all the money that we've put into this project, is it ready to go live? Is it going to fall over, and is it going to make us look bad? And if you can't do a load test and say yes to the client, say, yeah, we're going to be fine, then there's not really a point to it. And so quite often that happens because we look at load testing the wrong things. We, as technical people, get intrigued about, oh, what will happen if we try and do 1,000 page views per second at this one URL, and you know, go, oh, wow, look at that Advantage cache at all. It's amazing. And it doesn't really matter, right, because we're never going to get to that rate. But if there's some AJAX request that you didn't test in your load test that hits on every page and it's on a post, you know, it's HTTP post or something, it'll take your site down and you need to find that very quickly. So don't measure technical metrics. So things like page views per second, hits per second, or megabytes per second. So not bandwidth, not how many pages you impressions you get, or Drupal requests that you get. That's not how you want to do your metrics when you measure things at first. It's fine to have them, but at first, when you figure out what your goals are, these should not be your goals. Instead, you want to be thinking about business metrics. So how many users do you have at peak? And you can usually find that from historical data in Google. You know, it tells you per hour, and you might want to ask them. Yeah, I ask my clients, how many page views do you get per day? And they'll tell me. And I say, what percentage of that will go through in your peak hour? And it makes them think on their head and sort of shows how well they know their user base. And it gives me the number to work with. And when I ask them that, then they've now told me what success looks like, and I can test against that. So I do that. I also then find out how long a user stays around on the site for. One thing that is a constant concern is customers might say, I want to serve 100 users concurrently. And when they say that, developers say, oh, they want 100 hits per second. And that's never actually the case. They just mean that if there's 100 users on the site at one time, what does it look like? And of course, those 100 users are in several different states, right? They're requesting, they're reading content, or they're doing something else, right? It's not necessarily that they're implying load on the servers. So we figure out what the session duration is and how many page views they would hit during that session. And once we have those three pieces of information, it becomes trivial to be able to map those things over into technical metrics. So here is an example. I have 10,000 users at peak, and each user stays on the site for 20 minutes per session. And during that, they request 10 pages during that session. So mapping that over to technical metrics, I take those 10,000 users and I divide it by 60 divided by 20. In other words, I turn that 20 minutes and figure out how many times that reiterates over in a one-hour period, because the 10,000 users was at peak during that hour. So it's an average. And that turned out to be 3,333 concurrent users. So at any given time, that's the concept of concurrent from a user perspective. then the user request rate is 20 divided by 10. So take the session time and divide that by the number of page views. So they request on average 0.5 pages per minute, or in other words, they only request one every 2 minutes. We can convert that down to a second. And then we also have a measurement here so that we know that our math is correct. We have a check here. So the number of pages that we should be seeing requested to the site in an hour would be 10 times 10,000, so 100,000 page views. So then we can finally convert that over to a technical metric and say page views per second equals our user request rate times the number of concurrent users we have, which becomes 28 per second. And if we took 28 per second, times it by 60 minutes, and then by 60 seconds to get the minute value, and then by 60 again to get the hour value, we would get a number very close to 100,000. It wouldn't be the same because of the rounding. So get to know your tools. So this is about our things like logging and monitoring. We'll have questions at the end, so perhaps we can do that then. So now I'm just going to talk about a bunch of tools that I've used and that I kind of rate, as well as ones that I don't use, but I'll show them there nevertheless. So the first one is New Relic. It's a paid-for tool. Anyone use this to date? Cool. So if you use this at the moment and you're continuing to pay these guys, then you must value this product. I certainly rate it. Here we've got a graph of your performance over time. And this is really important because we kind of think of a number like a constant that represents the performance of your site. But in actual fact, it comes and goes depending on the load that you have. And at different load times, things are going to behave in different ways. And so New Relic has a really great way of showing that over time. So this is a time graph, and it's separated out into four different values. There's a green value there, which represents web traffic, so how long it took to transfer the content. The blue is Memcache, how much time was spent in Memcache. The orange is database, and the blue, the teal at the bottom is PHP. So how much time was spent in PHP. So this is really great, because when you're looking at a page view that took 3 seconds, you can immediately see the breakdown of where that 3 seconds was spent. And if it looks really odd, then you can immediately know where to look, right? So if the database was the part that was spiking, then you can say, well, I need to go look in the database and look for slow queries or something and figure out what went wrong there. If it was in PHP, then you can start looking into the application. And in fact, the other thing that New Relic does is it does stack tracing. So if you pay for the pro subscription, you will get stack traces and be able to look inside of your application and find the exact function that causes all of the time to be wasted away. And so you can look at optimizing that component or whatever it is. So it's really very valuable, but obviously it's a paid product and it does cost people. Not everyone can afford the budget for this kind of thing. So there are open source tools around as well that will do close enough jobs to what New Relic does. The first one is XHProf. And XHProf, just like New Relic, does stack tracing as well. It was contributed by Facebook. They used it to stack trace their problems. It's really quite powerful. In fact, I think it's a better stack tracer than New Relic is. But it only does it per request, whereas New Relic does it across your entire site of all your requests. So you kind of need to look into a couple of different profiles to understand truly what's going on. It does have all of these monitoring tools, both New Relic and XHProf, both have performance impacts to your page load. But I would say if you really need to do a lot of performance optimization, it's better to have the tools there that let you do that faster than to not have them at all. And you take you days to try and figure out, theorize what could be the problem, try and fix it, and then it not be the case. So XHProf here actually lets you order things by memory usage or wall time, which wall time is how long the CPU spent on that task. And that's really key because it lets you find very quickly what were the offending functions, and then you can stack trace out to find the appropriate area to remediate. It also does call graphing, so this is a map of the PHP call out, and it shows in this particular image a clear path where the performance defects lie. Another one that I haven't really used all that much, to be honest, is Xdebug. And you can take sampling from there and put it into an application called CacheGrind. It's free as well, yeah. It lets you, in a very similar way to what XHProf does, it lets you look at what happened during that page load inside of Drupal and dig into the helms of it and figure it out. I think at the very least, what you want to do in your application is log explicitly just Drupal requests to a log file. So by all means, have your Apache access log or whatever access log it is that log every request that comes in, but have a dedicated logging file for just Drupal as well. And the reason I say that is because it becomes really important to understand the requests that cause the most impact to your server. So static assets are really cheap, right? They're just file lookups and then serve them back, and if you have I/O issues, you'll see those in things like Nagios graphs or something. Whereas PHP is always CPU bound, and so that's where your web server is going to be spending a lot of its time. So look at, make sure you know how many Drupal requests are coming through per second so that you can understand and match it up to how many PHP processes you're giving your application. So if there's anything that you take away from today, write this formula down. This formula is what I use when I think about performance optimization and when I figure out what if the application is in its current state is going to live up to what the client wants it to do. So in most cases, with the exception of things like AJAX requests or private file system files, you can almost say that a page view correlates to exactly one Drupal request. There's plenty of exceptions for that, but let's just go with that for now. And then if they say that they want, if they give us their business metrics and we figure out what that means in page views per second, if we don't have that number of PHP procs plus, times the page load time average, then we don't know that we're going to be able to serve the site at capacity, right? So we use this to first figure that out. So page views per second in a theoretical sense, because remember earlier we mapped it from a business sense, so they're two very different metrics, is the PHP processes that you have available on your infrastructure divided by your page load time average. So let's say you have 10 PHP processes running on your application, and you have a load time average of 2 seconds. It takes 2 seconds to put your page together and send it back. Then that means you can only serve 5 concurrent page views per second, right? Because that PHP process is going to be occupied for 2 seconds before it can serve the next one. So as soon as you go over 5 page views per second as an incoming requests, Nginx Apache will start queuing them up, and you have to process them one at a time, and your page load time average starts getting bigger and bigger, right? Because it can't deal with the load. So you need to spread out how many PHP processes you have. That being said, you can't simply just add more PHP processes. They have to be scaled appropriately to your CPU. So if you have too many processes for against the CPU that you have, then your page load time will go up simply because the CPU is burdened by the amount of load it has, and it has to divide its time against how many processes you have. I use a sort of rule of thumb of 5 PHP processes to any CPU that I have on the server. So 2 CPUs means 10 processes per server. I don't need any more memory than that. What's going to facilitate that? And then I scale out horizontally from there. But that all depends on your application, right? If you've got a really, it's usually the more memory your application uses, the longer the page is going to take in general, just because it takes longer to deal with the memory. So it's like the shorter page load time you can get it without having to think about your CPU, the better off you're going to be anyway. My friend Mark Zumbabum, I hope I pronounced his name right, gave me this graph. He did some profiling to test what would happen if we had too many PHP requests loaded. So let's say this is like a graph that represents a server that has, say, actually he's got some numbers there. Say like 15 requests per second versus 15 PHP processes in the server versus 32 PHP processes in the server. Same size server, but one has less PHP processes configured and one has more. And what he found from the result query here is that as the number of requests increased, when you had a lesser amount of PHP procs, your times became more sporadic. And if you actually had more PHP processes, you could deal with more concurrent connections, and therefore your load times would also go up, but they were more consistent, so they all performed more badly across the board. So this is something to consider, and my preference it would be to keep that number low and keep your server safe. In other words, you don't want to get to a place where your load it goes so high that it becomes unresponsive and you lose that server altogether. So I would rather scale things out horizontally and have the more sporadic load times and have some of them be returned quite quickly and always have a performing architecture so that I can never blame that Drupal got slow because the CPU was too overtaxed than having the page load time for everything go up slowly. But that's something for you guys to determine for yourself. Just to sort of start summing this up, I wanted to actually do a sort of open session and get you guys to basically brainstorm with me and diagnose an issue in infrastructure. So I think of this like, sometimes I feel like I'm Gregory House, you know, like, not that I'm an asshole or anything, but, well, I don't think I am. But more that, like, you know, you have to think of these things in your head, like, from the data that I have observed, what could be the problem? And usually with experience, this becomes more and more prominent in your mind. But you have to use the tools that are available to you eventually to basically theorize what the problem is going to be and figure out how to solve it when you're trying to eliminate performance defects. So let's consider this architecture. We have a single Varnish server in the front. We have 6 Drupal servers running Memcache. We have a single database server in the back that's running the file partitions for the database and for the files. So the files are mounted onto the web servers over Gluster. Let's say it's Gluster. We've got 28 PHP procs per server. We have, there's some numbers in there that aren't relevant, sorry. 2 CPUs per server, 5.7 gigabytes of RAM per server. Of that, Memcache consumes 256 megabytes per server, right? That's our infrastructure. Now, when we look at the New Relic data that comes back, we're getting, at times, 3 seconds to load, and there's a very sporadic pattern there. And so my question to you is, from the data that I just gave you, both the infrastructure and the New Relic graph that we see here, what do you think the problem could be from an infrastructure perspective that might improve the situation? Database contention. If we look at this graph here, the orange part is the database line. And you can see it's the smallest component of the page load. Yes. So the answer there was use less Memcache servers, right? So reduce the number down or use sharding, right? So actually I probably should have, I just realized this wasn't clear. I should have explained that the Drupal servers share the Memcache servers. So one Drupal server over here on my left will connect to every single Memcache server so that it can distribute it out anyway. Yeah, but yeah, you're right. So if you can see here that the Memcache line, right, is exactly the same thickness as the CPU line in PHP. Now we know from this graph here that Memcache and Drupal are on the same servers. So whenever that server gets CPU bound, Memcache is affected. So your caching system is not as good when Drupal gets carried under. So if we were to separate them out in this architecture, it would decouple them, and the caching system would continue to perform just as good when the load gets high. And so it actually would mean that not only would the Memcache portion take less time, but it would also mean that Drupal would not be waiting as well. So the Drupal part would actually take less time as well. So we would get huge performance improvements if we were to make that change. Cool. Well, that actually took a lot less time than I thought it might have, so that's really cool. So thank you. That's all I had for my session. Thanks. If you have any questions, there's a microphone in the center of the room. Great. I guess there is one.
Yeah. What is the best way to optimize community sites, as a site where you have logged in users, where Waihi and all these other caching mechanisms don't work that well?
Right. So the question, so in most cases, your community site's not going to have page caching, right? So because of that, every request that's a Drupal request, will normally be a Drupal request, always hits Drupal and has to be processed. So that just means that you have a lot more request load, and that might mean that you're going to have to ultimately have more servers to deal with it, more PHP processes to be available. There are some other ways that you could optimize that in an application manner, right? Like I was saying earlier, that you can actually continue to serve anonymous pages in some circumstances and then render in with something like AJAX or ESIs the parts that are actually authenticated. For a community site where you're talking about like forums, that may not be so beneficial. I guess one thing you should probably always check off your checklist is make sure the DBlog module is never enabled. That's logging to the database. That just creates unnecessary writes. And you want to ensure that you have the entity cache module enabled. Usually only if you're using something like Memcache or Redis as a cache store. Then it allows you to store loaded entities in cache, and they don't have to redo that work. So what that means is that it reduces your page load time average, and the sooner that PHP process can be returned to the pool after a serving request, the sooner that it can serve another request, and so you're going to save money because you can serve a higher concurrency rate. Yeah. How can I know how many PHP processes are running on my server? So if you're using libmod PHP, or what comes inside a standard LAMP install, that's 256, because Apache doesn't rate limit that. But if you're using something like FPM, it'll have a configuration in its PHP INI file. I want to say INI file, but I think it's conf D. That is max underscore children, FPM max underscore children. And that'll tell you how many, basically FPM will limit itself to that many children. And you can also say how many are idle and how many you start with and how many are your max, which is the children. So you can say always have 5 open, but you can go up to 20. So if you're under a short amount of load, you can drop them all off again and remain idle for other things if you need to. Yeah. Yes. It's a great question. I myself haven't had enough time to play with Redis to really answer that in full. But what I can tell you is that Memcache does a really terrible job at caching from a Drupal perspective, right? It's a fast key value store, but one thing that the Drupal system does is it supports out of the box is wildcard caching, and that's something that Memcache does not support. So instead, the Memcache module in the Drupal community has to find an application layer level way of dealing with wildcard caching, and that unfortunately means it has to do additional caching. So if you can, Redis supports wildcard purging, so I would definitely recommend giving it a go, though I don't have any experience with it to be able to say. Right. Yeah, like I said, I would need to look into it a little bit more. And of course, you're talking about persistent storage, which, if you want to do master-slave, you care about the data that's inside of Redis, which is good for things like queuing, perhaps not so relevant for things like locking or cache store. Yeah, cool. Thanks. Yeah, come up to the microphone if you don't mind.
Hi. Talking about stack traces. I've used XHProth. Main problem I see with that is that you got lots of kind of multiplexer functions like module invoke or theme, where everything's calling it, and then yes, it could be calling 50 different functions depending on where it's coming from, and yeah, finding your way through that and working out where the choke point is really tricky. Any way getting around that?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually, because it's something that I had to figure out myself as well. So I'm going to go back to the screenshot here. So this is what you would see by default. And like you say, when you in Drupal, a function like module invoke all or calls a whole lot of different functions, and it gets called itself a lot of times. And there's things like call user func array. What you'll end up doing is you'll start to understand what it is in Drupal that gets called a lot. But it's not the fact that it gets called a lot that's the issue. It's about what's calling it a lot that might be the problem. In most cases, the hook systems aren't abused by the most well supported modules, so you wouldn't find module hook. Module, I can't remember what it's called, module vocal being an issue, but there would be scenarios where other things might be that way. In those cases, you'll see on the side here that there's a column called calls, and it tells you how many times that got called. In those instances, I would look at the in XHProf, you can look at a single function, it'll tell you the children functions that it calls. And it'll also tell you the parent function that calls it, or the number of different parent functions that call it. So normally, if you see a function that gets called a lot of times, and that's a problem, you'd look at the parent functions and look at the parent functions that call it a lot of times, right? And then I start tracking that way through the stack. So when you get into those places where there's a single function that a lot of different ctools is a good example of this. You know, like all points to a single function, and then they all sort of fork out again. You can do that. The other alternative would be to actually render a call graph and look at it that way. So again, you can see here that it has that yellow trail that tells you where the performance line is being caused. And so in those instances, you can just use the call graph to find it very quickly what part is really causing you the issue.
Cheers. I'll just add one thing I did find, which was quite useful, was when you're running as administrator, as user one, it does a lot more checks when building the menu system than it does when you're not. And we've not looked at it. We're not user one. It can cache it, but in the user one, it never caches it. And if that's doing security checks on every single link, that can really expand the time. So that's an interesting one.
Cool. Thanks. Is there anybody else? Otherwise, I can all release you for beer. Go forth. Thanks.